You're listening to KAOR, Vermilion, South Dakota.
The opinions expressed in this program are not necessarily those of this station, the USD Department of Media and Journalism, or the University of South Dakota.
The CharCole Sports Show, the hottest names and the hottest takes.
Tune in every Wednesday from 6 to 7 p.m., where Charlie Prien and Cole Larsch highlight prep sports, college sports, Coyote athletics, and professional sports. We would love to hear your questions for us, too. The phone lines are always open.
Tune in to the CharCole Sports Show each Wednesday from 6 to 7 p.m. to hear the hottest takes on KAOR Vermilion.
Welcome back to the CharCole Sports Show. It is Wednesday, September the 4th, 2024. Thanks for tuning in. Season 2, Episode 2 of the show. Lots of stuff planned, so here we go. First off, we start off with USD Sports, where the football and volleyball teams went undefeated last week before moving on to a recap of the SD Prep Sports Weekend and our reaction to the latest media polls. Then we move into a deep dive on the Minnesota Vikings. Which games do they win or lose? And our overall thoughts of the season. As always, we wrap up with our picks of the week and our new segment, the NFL Losers of the Week. Feel free to tune into that. That'll be about 6:55. Again, you can always call into the CharCole Sports Show at any time, 605-658-6813. The phones are working, and we will probably answer the phone. Buckle in, because the CharCole Sports Show starts right now.
Season two.
Great start. Yeah.
Season two, episode two of the CharCole Sports Show. I'm Charlie Prien, joined by Cole Larsch as usual. And it's just us in the studio today. No guests, but we might have some in the future if we have time for a show. We're still trying to cram as much in from the summer and in previews
That's
and stuff.
True.
But, yeah, I think last episode we got a lot accomplished if you actually go back and listen to it, which you can do on pretty much all mediums, including YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and is that it?
I'm sure you can find it elsewhere. I'm not sure where it all uploads to. I know it's those three for sure. Just look up the CharCole Sports Show on any of them.
I know once you put some stuff on YouTube, it can get tossed around in some certain places. I know we're on some weird podcast apps, too.
Probably like iHeartMedia and things like that. I don't know. Actually, I could look that up, honestly.
We're in some odd places, but the best way to support us is through Spotify. But, I mean, we'll take any listeners of our VOD after the fact, but... Our show from last week is up. You can find that on a variety of different places. Just look up the CharCole Sports Show, C-H-A-R-C-O-L-E, and the CharCole Sports Show. Again, if you want to call into the show at any time today, we'll take your call. That number to call in is 605-658-6813. That number one more time, 605-658-6813. Cole,
We have a download of our podcast from South America. Shout out to whoever's listening down in South America.
I looked us up one time, and there's some funky apps. It's like when you do sports or high school sports live streams, Cole.
Yeah.
And you always get those weird streams that aren't actually your stream. Our podcasts are actually out there on other places.
Like you want the list? There. Apple, Spotify, Amazon Music, Overcast, iHeartRadio, Castro, Castbox, Good Pods, and Podfriend.
And we pay for one of them.
One.
Well,
we pay for one.
There's that. I guess that's a one price fits all.
But yeah,
we'll
buddy.
Take it. Yeah, you can find us in a lot of places. Anyway, season two, episode two. It's going to be a fun episode. Our new segment, we're premiering that today. Really excited to go into that. But it's going to be a great show. We get to talk about some stuff that I'm really passionate and excited about. And I think Cole feels the same way. But again, if you want to call into the show at any time, our number, one more time before we get into USD Sports, is 605-658-6813. That number, 605-658-6813. 800-919-8813. Cole, let's get in to our first segment of the day, USD Sports. And, well, we took care of business on the football front, and it was a fun game we were both in attendance for.
Yeah, they were. It was also over 2,300 students in attendance overall. I did count the official student attendance because I scanned my phone to get the cowboy hat.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I got the first and it was faulty. So I got the first cowboy hat and it didn't work. I haven't seen it since, honestly. I'm not sure where it ended up. But yeah, 7,435 people in attendance. The game took 2 hours and 38 minutes. Again, your final score of the USD Coyotes, 45, the Northern State Wolves, 3. Northern State led things off with a 24-yard field goal from Jeremy Caruso, and USD scored 45 unanswered points. There was a kickoff return, a 52-yard field goal, a 5-yard run, a punt return for 55 yards, another 3-yard run, a 10-yard run, and a 14-yard run, all for touchdowns. Excuse me, to make that 45-3 as I get to some of the individual stats for USD. Aiden Bauman, 9 for 12, 85 yards. His longest was 19. It was the rushing game for USD that got things going. Charles Pierre Jr., 13 carries, 136 yards, 2 touchdowns. Travis Tice, 12 carries, 86 yards, and a touchdown. LJ Phillips Jr., 5 carries, 34 yards, and a touchdown. And Jarrett Sinek with 2 carries and 20 yards. Aiden Bauman officially 3 rush attempts for -4 overall.
Well, Cole, you got to continue with stats, or do you want to do an
Yeah, I can. I continue for a little bit.
I don't have too much to say.
There wasn't much receiving stats for USD. Carter Bell, 3 catches for 32. Charles Pierre Jr., 2 catches for 20. Jack Martin's a catch for 19. Javion Phelps, a catch for 7. And J.J. Galbraith, 2 catches for 7 yards for Northern State. Hank Kraft actually scared us right away to start. 11 carries. He had 68 net yards. He opened up the game with a 42-yard run that got him from the 3-yard line back to the 45, and I thought to myself, oh boy, here we go. But that turns out our defense was like, okay, here we go, let's lock in a little bit, and then gave up 3 points, and not very many yards after that. Daniel Britt, 8 for 11 for 60 yards and an interception for Northern State. He was sacked once. Defensively for USD, Gary Bryant, the third officially with 8 total tackles. Mike East Grace with 6 tackles, including a tackle and a half for loss. Our one sack was Nick Gase with an 11-yard sack. Other than that, I don't have much stats to report. Big win.
Yeah, it was a big win, Cole. We got a win over an in-state foe. I wouldn't even call it a foe, but we got a win over the Northern State Wolves. And let's talk about the first quarter of the game. I think it was the most interesting part of all four quarters when the ones were out there on both sides respectively. And when you look at it, Cole, I think you find that both teams really came out firing, and you could tell that both head coaches and offensive coordinators specifically had their pregame script down, and the script's probably been done for a month, so
yeah, probably
these coaches knew exactly what was going to be ran, and so did the players. And then after that, things fell apart for both sides to an extent. South Dakota had a lot of big plays that helped them move things along and throw up the 45. But let's talk about the first drive for Northern State. You mentioned Hank Kraft moving the ball down the field with ease. That offensive line didn't look great. It was just they knew what was expected of them, and they've probably drilled this first series of plays 10 times over the summer leading up to this game. So it was just automatic for them. And if Hank Kraft didn't step out of bounds, he probably would have scored on that one really long play.
The first play.
Yeah. So, it was definitely interesting. We spoke about it last week on our show, Cole. And the one thing we said that is going to be the scary part for the Coyotes this year, especially if they're going to try to run that three down linemen and that rush linebacker. That rush linebacker, and nothing against Mike East Grace, he's not going to be able to stop the run like Nick Gase is on the other side. Because if you watch, I mean, it's not rocket science. Nick Gase is always on the strong side, and Mike East Grace is always on the weak side and rushing the passer. Well, here's the deal. If you run a weak side into the short side of the field, Mike East Grace is standing there, gets washed out by a wide receiver, and all of a sudden Hank Kraft is off to the races. Well, any team sees that and says, hey, we're going to attack that. So I think that that's one thing that the Yotes have to fix is their run stopping, Cole. And they really showed early in that game. And as much as Valley teams run the ball with consistency, you have to be able to stop the run and hunker down. And honestly, we got to be smarter with our packaging, especially on first and second down, because that run was on an early down. It wasn't like it was a third and long and they handed a draw off. No, it was just a simple Mike East Grace got washed out to the left side, and he was on the weak side, short side, and it was a big run. So that's the one thing that I think is one thing we got to fix. But we looked really good in a lot of aspects, and I think special teams stuck out too, Cole.
I think that was...
besides their kicking game, that was odd.
Yeah, it was kind of uncharacteristic, you could say, almost, as now both kickers are listed as or. Will Leyland and Zeke Mata is either or for starters now, which I was surprised that we didn't stick with one for most of it and one for the other. I mean, we came out in that opening drive and nailed that field goal. I was expecting a punt. When they came up there, I'm looking for a punter and a punt returner. I'm like, oh, they're lining up for a kick. It's like 52 yards. I'm like, oh, all righty then. Looks like we're kicking the ball. It's right down the middle.
It looked good. And then the next one was a knuckleball. I mean, it truly was a knuckleball. It looked like I'm saying this in the nicest way because Leyland won us some games last year. But that thing, I mean, Cole, you could have probably put a better boot on that one. It was just, I don't know if he lost his footing, if it was the new turf or the lighting or anything. But
yeah, I don't know.
I mean, I'm sure Leyland's kicked a lot of balls in there, so he doesn't need to be outside. You keep him inside on that turf all the time for his practices.
Yeah, if they're outside, they're on the turf outside.
Right, but it's not the same.
Well, yeah, obviously.
So it's just, well, I see what you're saying, yes.
Yeah, right.
Especially for this week. But I'm saying he's probably practiced in the dome quite extensively, and it was just really odd. The snaps were great. I will say that the snaps were great and the holds were good as well. So that's the one thing I think is questionable moving forward. And you mentioned the or on the depth chart. We'll see how that pans out. If we get close enough to kick a field goal this week, it'd be nice to see some field goals made. But 45-3, that's kind of my final take on that one, Cole. We looked good in a lot of aspects, and I think the offense was feeling some things out, but they didn't want to show too much moving forward. So they were pretty stock, if you will, heading into this week against a Big Ten foe.
I agree. It's going to be a big week. Last check, USD is plus 12. So
that is crazy.
That is an interestingly low number for an FBS-FCS matchup. Then again, Wisconsin also played Central Michigan last week and looked awful. Like, Central Michigan at some point should have won that game.
Oh, 100%. They had the opportunities to. It's just a couple errant catches. I mean, the throws were fine. I mean, honestly, if I'm the wide receiver corps for Central Michigan, I'm kind of hanging my head after that one, if that's the word. But that was winnable. And the Badgers kind of looked beatable. And I think Vegas got to see that and said, hey, we're going to make this only a 12-point spread. But I told, I was joking around, Cole, you were there yesterday with John Thayer, the voice of the Coyotes. He was talking about he was going to be interviewing the voice of the Badgers up in Wisconsin and exchanging some information among just – simple questioning, and I said, well, one of the questions you should ask him is why the heck the line for this one is so close and why Wisconsin's only favored by 12 right now. And he laughed and said, yeah, I probably won't ask that. But nonetheless, the Yotes are definitely viewed to be close in this one, and I'm really excited because most of the FCS-FBS games aren't quite working out. And Cole, so far, yes?
That's the basketball line.
Oh, it is? What? What's the football line?
I don't know. I mean, look.
Are you sure? I'm pretty sure I saw
it. I just looked at it. The over-under for the first half is 62.5. There is no spread.
Are you looking on ESPN?
I'm looking on the Action Network, which always has them. There is no spread officially.
There is no spread. But I saw it somewhere else, too. I saw it on Twitter. I saw it on Twitter, Cole.
Yeah, that was the basketball one. I'm looking at the same thing.
Really?
The team total for USD is over 62.5. That's basketball. From November 7th at 7:30 p.m. last year.
No, I saw a tweet that was more recent than that.
Yeah, but they're looking at that. I guarantee they're looking at that. Well, USD is 7-3 against the spread in their last 10 games. The total has gone over in 7 out of the last 10. Okay, that's not right either because it says South Dakota's 0-5 straight up in their last 5. That's not. Yeah, so I don't think there's a line. It'll come out on Saturday.
I'm guessing. I'm looking on Twitter, but I can't find anything too great. Yeah. Well, anyways.
Predicted score 31-26 according to this website.
Which is
there's no official line here.
So our point in saying all of this is a Big Ten team who is historically one of the best running teams in the country is going to face, in my opinion, probably on the lower end of running defenses in the Valley this year in USD, and we're only favored to lose by 2 scores. There's a chance. There's more than a chance, we think. Might be closer than that, honestly. But yeah, 45-3 last week, and this week we head to Camp Randall Stadium. All parties except fans and the band have to drive up there. They're flying the team out, flying them into Madison out of Sioux Falls, according to sources. So they will fly a couple, I'd say probably close to 100 or so personnel, maybe even a couple hundred. Personnel out to Madison for the game. And, it's a real opportunity to go get a win for you and boost your stock after getting a win over a D2 team in state. But, Cole, I will reiterate it. We looked tough in the first quarter, and I think that was because we didn't want to show our hand too much. And I also am considering this. Does Bob Nielsen truly care to win this game? I mean,
what are you talking about?
No. Right? Hear me out. It doesn't really matter. We lose the game, we lose the game. Is he going to show his hand? Because it matters more in Valley play than it does in your second game of the year against a Big Ten team who's paying you to come up there. I don't know. We'll have to look
at that. I think they're going to go out and try and win it, Charlie.
I think they're going to try to win, but do you call your best plays? Do you call your best plays this? I mean, what I'm saying is Bill Belichick was on McAfee today, and he was talking about how early season most coaches don't show their hand for a long time, and the playbook's not totally open. That's what I meant to say.
But I also don't think maybe the playbook's not fully developed yet. It's week 2.
Fair, but most offensive coordinators have a pretty good idea coming into the not even just the first game, the second game.
They might
more.
Save some stuff, sure, but it's not like they're going to hold back half their playbook.
Yeah, I don't know. We'll see.
They'll call 90% of it. I bet. Also, according to Reddit FCS, the scorebook, which on historically is also very close. Wisconsin -20. The over-under is 45.5.
That's kind of low.
Again, historically, this is they're usually pretty solid. FCS games, 87% of the time they get the correct winner. The spread's off by about 3. FBS game, 90%. The spread's off by about 2.5.
Really?
So that's what...
not bad.
That's where they're at right now.
All right, Cole. Well, that's football, and it's a big week. We truly have an opportunity to go make something happen. It's a 2:30 kickoff
FS1.
In Camp Randall.
FS1, baby.
FS1 is right. John Thayer will have that on the Coyote Radio Network, and it'll also be on the Varsity app there in Madison. So, Cole, let's get on to the USD volleyball team. They're 2-0. And they looked pretty decent in their early games. They had a game against Northern Iowa that did not happen. But they played Fordham and Air Force and won both games 3-0. And honestly, this was at the Amy Svoboda Memorial Classic in Colorado. And I wonder if that Svoboda, Amy Svoboda, is related to the Svoboda that's a quarterback for Wyoming Cowboys, because I had that Evan Svoboda, who was the quarterback in my rebuild for the Wyoming Cowboys, and
oh, yeah.
He was good.
It honestly might be.
He actually transferred out on me like his junior year, so it kind of made me sad.
What the heck?
I know, but the Amy Svoboda Classic, the Coyote women go 3-0 and 3-0. I think the win over Air Force was a little bit more competitive than I think. Ooh, I accidentally just closed the tab. I shouldn't have. But But, yeah, so let's break this down. USD won the first set 25-14, second set 25-20, and final set 25-20 as well. So, Cole, closer sets, but the we'll look at some stats here in a little bit. One thing that stuck out to me, 99 people in attendance, according to the website.
And I think 95 of them were USD.
Did you watch the game? Or
Yes, I watched parts of it, and I believe there was about 95 people in red, and the other four might have been workers that they counted.
Man, Fordham probably didn't travel too well. I'm not sure where they are out of.
I don't know either.
They're in the A-10, the Atlantic 10, so I assume they're from the East Coast. But
yeah, then they got that win over Air Force with 373 people. It was packed. I mean, that's not a big gym that they're playing in, from what I could tell.
Mount Vernon High School clears?
Close. The ceiling's definitely higher, but it might not be, because there's a couple of them that glanced off the ceiling in Volleyball.
That's tough
to play. But you start off 2-0, and then this weekend they travel to the Northern Kentucky Invitational. They might have already left. I'm not sure. They play Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. They play number 4 Louisville on Friday. They play Northern Kentucky on Saturday, and they play Missouri, who is receiving votes on Sunday.
Well, we have a real chance to shock the world.
Those will all be on ESPN Plus, I believe.
Yeah. We have a real chance to shock everybody right now. Here's the thing. Louisville's 2-1. They dropped one to Penn State, and I saw some highlights of that one, and they looked pretty good. Penn State did. But the wins they do have, they beat Wisconsin 3-1 and Tennessee 3-0. So this is going to be a big one in Highland Heights, Kentucky. I'm really looking forward to seeing this, and give a shout out to my sister. She's like, why the heck aren't they playing in Vermilion again? Because I think everyone wants Louisville to come back, especially since
that was my freshman year, the first ever game I went to here at USD. It was like 3,000 people in attendance. It was unbelievable.
So I think the consensus is trying to get Louisville back, but Louisville are rated 4. I think they'll drop in the rankings next week. But hopefully the Coyotes can get things done, and then you take on Northern Kentucky. That should be a win. And
they are 1-2, Northern Kentucky is.
And then you take on a Missouri team who receives votes in the poll, and I think they're going to jolt up in the poll, especially if they can, because I think this is kind of a round-robin invitational where everybody plays everybody.
Yeah, it is. That's usually how it goes.
So you'll assume that Missouri plays Louisville, and we'll see how Missouri does play against the Cardinals. But Louisville, the team to beat here.
Missouri is 2-1.
Who'd they lose to?
They lost to number 12 Creighton, 3-0. They defeated Drake, lost to Creighton, defeated NC State.
One thing I do want to mention, Cole, during this time in volleyball adjacent, Bergen Riley, the first Red Bull NIL athlete in its history, I guess. So that's pretty cool. Red Bull does
female.
First female. Is that confirmed?
I'm pretty sure.
But I thought I read it was she was the first actual. But anyways,
it might be. Yeah.
She obviously the South Dakota native and is playing volleyball for the Huskers. Was the Big Ten setter of the week this week in the Big Ten. They had a pretty good run of games, and shout out to Bergen. She's getting a bag for the Huskers, and she's pretty darn good. And the Huskers teams that looks pretty good. Texas went down, number one team in the
Nebraska
country.
Also lost.
Did they? Who'd they lose to?
They lost to SMU last night.
Okay, that's tough.
Tough loss.
A lot of weird games in the volleyball world right now because Texas lost to Cole.
Yeah. I think Pitt lost.
That's crazy.
So I think three out of the top four teams, I think maybe all the top four teams lost.
Yotes are number one in the country.
Bring it on.
That'd be cool. But yeah.
We better move on. We're 10 minutes behind.
Are we actually?
Yes.
Oh, Lord.
Well, we talked about football for 15.
Oh, my gosh, we did.
Well, you did.
We're good.
Also, want to give out to the shout out to the soccer team. They're at home on Sunday at 1 p.m. They're currently 2-2-1. They defeated Drake 3-2 on Thursday in the rain right before the football game and even during the football game. And they were scoreless at half at Kansas State. And then they gave up 3 goals, lost 3-0. They travel to Central Michigan Thursday. They host Portland State on Sunday at 1 o'clock at the First Bank and Trust Soccer Complex. We better move on.
We best. Let's get into South Dakota Prep High School sports. Let's talk about football first. Cole, I'll kind of let you breeze through these, and I'll talk about it if I think of anything's important. But
yep.
Before we move,
we gotta roll.
I know we got to roll, but Cole, what the heck is going on in our state of football right now?
I'm really honestly not very sure. It's not even kind of been interesting. It's been pretty goofy.
Goofies.
To say the least. Yeah. I don't know. Maybe it's just the early season, and we've only seen one or two games from each class. That's why we're overreacting a little bit. But I don't know.
It's not boring. I'll tell you that.
No, it is not. There's a lot of upsets each. Okay. Class 11, AAA. Harrisburg 1, Lincoln 2, both receiving first place votes. Brandon Valley 3. O'Gorman lost and stayed 4. Jefferson 5. They moved up one spot. Washington Roosevelt receiving votes. So really no big changes there. In Class 11 AA, Pier number 1, Yankton got a first-place vote there in second. I don't know who voted for them in first, but that's egregious. Spearfish is in third. They went from not being ranked to third. Watertown is fourth. Aberdeen Central, fifth. They did not move. T Area went from third to receiving votes. Brooking received votes. And Mitchell.
This has got to be the worst poll in the state.
I agree.
In all classes, this is the worst.
That's unbelievable. Whatever.
Also, this is the worst 11 AA has ever been, ever.
Yes. You take away the top two teams, it's going to be the top two teams in the Dome, and the rest of them are just playing just to get out there and play.
They're just going out there to field the team.
Pretty much. 11A, Canton remains number one. Sioux Falls Christian remains number two. Dakota Valley jumps up to 3. Lenox received a first-place vote. They are 4th. Rapid City Christian lost and is 5th. Del Rapids, Tri-Valley, Madison, West Central receiving votes. Another interesting poll.
Yeah, I don't got too much to say about that. I think West Central is better than people think still, but there's still a lot of room to go here.
Yeah, a lot of weeks left. Class 11B, winner number 1, no surprise. Elk Point Jefferson 2, no surprise. Sioux Valley 3, no change there. WWSSC remains 4th. Beresford jumps into the 5th spot. MVP Wagner, Hot Springs receiving votes.
What a weird week in 11B. Wagner probably didn't get 50 by winner for the first time in the last 12, 13 years.
At least.
And they kept it close.
Yeah,
Ryan Deal was at the game. It was in Wagner, and Wagner loses a close-ish one.
It was 26-6 or something like that.
And for the longest time, it was close. Wagner punched a score in first. But, winner hunkered down and found a way to win. But after that, it was a pretty sizable swing among first-place votes, and they're now distributed among 3 teams at the top of Class 11B.
I can confidently say that I voted for the number 3 team to be in first place. I will stand by that.
I agree, and I think that's the team that's going to win the class.
We move down to 9-man in 9AA. Parkston number 1 with 18 first-place votes. Hamlin in 2nd with 4. Elkton Lake Benton in 3rd, so no change there. Hill City moves up to 4th. Viberg-Hurley takes the loss and remains in 5th. Hanson, Kimball, White Lake, FMFA, and Bennett County receiving votes in 9AA.
Yeah, Hamlin got a win over Hanson, and that was pretty much the only game last week that was notable in Class 9AA. There was a pretty big one also that went down. Scotland Menno had a real chance to go out and take care of business against Corsica Stickney, and they just did not.
Yeah, they didn't. I think Elkton Lake Benton played Viber Hurley, if I remember.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. There you go. No, I think that's this week. Is it not? Or it might be. I think you're right.
Probably something we should know.
Yeah.
You'd think.
Anyways.
Right. Yeah, whatever.
Hamlin looked pretty good, and they gained some first-place votes in doing so. I still think Parkston's the team to beat.
I agree. I did not vote for them first, but I do believe they are the team to beat. 9A, Howard 1, Wall 2. They got 1 first-place vote. I don't know who that person. I got a good guess, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Warner 3, Woolsey-Weston 4, Harding County Bison 5. So even though Harding County Bison lost to Wall, they are still that top 5 has not changed.
I don't like this poll, man. Like, I don't feel like – I think Howard's the only team that I think is solidified up there. I think any of the other teams can slip around there. I think Harding County Bison's better than people think, too. They have a pretty good athlete.
I don't know what – you know what we could do in this segment is show how I or we voted. Depending
yeah.
on how you want to look at it.
You could, definitely.
9A, I had Howard – I had – nope, that's the overall one. Hold up. I had Howard 1, Warner 2, Woolsey-Weston 3, Wall 4, Harding County Bison 5. Because I think if Harding County Bison plays Wall later in the season, they win. Same deal with the Wagner winner game.
I think I don't know if I want to agree with the second one because I don't know if Wagner knows how to win in the playoffs. But
well, not in the playoffs, like week 6.
Okay.
Instead of week 2.
Oh, yes. Okay.
If they play later in the regular season.
Yes. Okay.
Yes. Okay, yes.
Yes, and I think your 9A poll is probably how I would put it, but still right now I think Elcester Hudson, you can make a case for Elcester Hudson to even be in the top three. Like, that's where I'm at right now with 9A. Like, it is such an open field.
It is Howard, and then who knows?
Yeah, who does? I think Chester's even 1-0 right now, and they got a vote in the poll for fifth place. I don't hate it. I mean, I think you could probably put another couple teams in there for votes.
Yeah, you could.
I don't know. Weird.
We move down to 9B, Avon, the unanimous number one seed once again. Falkton 2, Corsica Stickney 3, Dale Rapids St. Mary 4, Sully Buttes 5, Kadoka area, Canasota, Harriet Selby area receiving votes.
Pretty solid top two. I don't know. I mean, I like Corsica Stickney a lot more after their win, and we're going to learn a lot more about them this week because guess who they play? TDA ACDC.
Yes, they do. Another 9AA school.
Yeah, so they're going to have to prove themselves again, and if they do, I think you can make a case for Corsica Stickney to be number two.
You could. I actually put them number two. What's crazy is I did not have Falkton area in my top five.
Yeah. I think you're the one who's really keeping them back.
Probably. But
what have they proven played one game? I mean, Avon's
right, and they played
course,
they play?
I think Corsica Stickney's got the best resume in 9B. I don't even 100%.
It's just Avon got way more talent. Well, that's all right.
Yeah, I mean, well, and then actually, Dale Rapids St. Mary's, you can make a case for them to
you
be.
You could, yeah.
I think you can make a case for Dale St. Mary's to be ahead of Falkton.
Sneaky team to look out for in 9B, the Kadoka area Cougars.
I can
mark
second
my
that.
Words.
Well, Ryan did a tweet or a poster right
up did?
On
him. Of course they stole my thunder.
Yeah, they did.
He probably saw my vote and he's like, oh, that's a good point. Actually, he probably saw a lot of my votes and said, what in the world is this guy thinking?
Larsch, you and I are actually usually pretty close, like with rankings at least.
The only thing that I goofed up on this week is
the low-ranking people who we have no idea about.
Well, that too. And 11A, I put Lennox as my number one.
What did you say?
I put Lennox as my number one for 11A, which is not egregious.
Which I don't hate it.
Heath Nimke made me sound like a... I can't say that word on air.
Don't. I thought you were going to do it for a second. I'm like, shoot.
You made me sound like at our volleyball game yesterday. Mm-hmm. We're speaking in sign language now.
Yeah.
I'm taking a sign language class, so Charlie's learning sign language as we go.
I know. Continue, Cole.
But yeah, other than that, I was just about dead on, and but that's the thing when you have 22 voters in this thing. You're not going to see much change week to week unless everybody votes for the same team.
Yeah.
But well, that's just how she goes.
Should we get to volleyball, huh?
We should. I mean, now we're only 5 minutes
behind. Yeah, we scoot through volleyball real quick.
Yeah, you want me to run through it very quickly?
Yeah, I don't
really. Class double A, no change.
Please hold, please hold, please hold. There has been some big changes in double A. There were some upsets last night. I would like to talk about that.
Upset last night? All right, you're going to have to inform me here.
I'm going to. There is some big upsets. I got to find it.
You better find it.
Remember, here we go.
Can't spread false information.
Also, I meant Class A, but...
Okay, can I run through double A first?
Yeah, run through double A. My bad. I was thinking Class A, but
okay,
I did.
Double A, no change except for 4 and 5 swaps, so Harrisburg unanimous number 1, O'Gorman 2, Washington 3, Jefferson moves to 4, Watertown slides to 5, Lincoln receiving votes. All right, now we move to Class A.
What the heck is happening? This is what I meant to freak out
about.
Yeah,
okay. Del Rapids receives 6 first place votes, and they are number 1. Sioux Falls Christian receives 8 first-place votes, but because they have less total votes, they moved down to second. They have 2 less total votes and 2 more first-place votes. I wonder if those are backwards. I don't think so, though.
I don't think so. I think it goes by total.
Yeah, I know it goes by total, but I wonder if old Ryan Deal mixed up the first-place vote numbers. That's all right. I don't think he did. Miller moves up to 3. Baltic moves up to 4. Dakota Valley sneaks into 5. Rapid City Christian, Hill City, St. Thomas More, and Hanson receiving votes.
What is happening to Sioux Falls Christian?
Well, you know who they lost to 3 times?
Mm-mm.
I will pull up.
I can't find it on SD Score Feed, but I will
pull up the email right now. They lost to Bishop Heelan out of Iowa.
I've been to that high school twice.
Oh, that's not the right one.
And
okay, here we go.
They're pretty solid. Catholic school.
Here we go. Yep, Sioux Falls Christian. They defeated T Area. They lost to Iowa 4A number 2. Bishop Heelan. They lost to Iowa 4A number 15, Sergeant Bluff. And they lost to Unity Christian.
Sergeant Bluff.
Sergeant Bluff Luton, sorry.
Oh, not even.
All of them were 2-1 in a tournament.
Then they beat Yankton last night, who was 1-4. They 3-set to them. But the big one is going to be Del Rapids. They play Del Rapids tomorrow.
That'll be a big one. That'll be a big one.
Indeed. All right, Cole.
All right. We move to Class B.
Oh, also, Hanson got a vote. Look at that.
Look at that.
And they got a win last night.
Chester, number 1. Warner, 2. Northwestern, 3. Burke, 4. Hitchcock-Tulare, 5. No changes there, even though Hitchcock-Tulare did not play, which is odd.
Anyway, what are they doing? They're holding out.
I don't know. They must be.
They're holding out to keep their plays in the poll.
They must be. All right. We move to the Vikings because we don't have time for a break because we always run late in case you've never listened to this show.
But if you do want to call in, you sure can.
That is absolutely. Yeah. You want to say the number while I put the schedule?
Yeah. 605-658-6813. That number one more time. Get your pen or pencil or just put it into your phone. 605-658-6813 to call into the CharCole Sports Show. We're going to talk about the Vikings. If you want to talk about the Vikings, high school sports, USD sports, college sports, we'll take it all. Call into the CharCole Sports Show. That number one more time before we talk about the Vikings, 605-658-6813. Cole, let's talk about our Minnesota Vikings. Game week.
Game week it is. They play Sunday.
Can you believe that? We've been waiting for this.
I know. Unbelievable. It's unbelievable.
Would you call this a revenge game? What they did to us? I mean, actually, what Ed Donatel did to us.
We played him last year, though. That's the thing.
Yeah.
And we didn't really do anything there, but.
What Ed Donatel.
Yeah, also, you're going to have to watch the light behind me because I don't have eyes in the back.
Okay, I am.
Do you want to dim the. Oh, it's whatever. We'll be fine. All right, we open up the season noon on Fox. Sunday, September 8th. This Sunday, we play at the New York Giants.
Are we going to do our predictions here? We probably should.
Yes, we should.
Okay.
So, are you going to tally them or should I?
I'll kind of tally mine. You can tell yours.
Okay.
I think we beat the Giants. I'm going to be bold with these predictions.
And I'm going to be more realistic. So, hey, you see what I did there in the document?
No.
Yeah, go back to it. Can you update our records as we say them there?
Yeah, I can.
All right, I can run.
You just tell me the game.
Yep.
You think we win or lose?
I think we come out and we win week one at the Giants. We squeak one away by 2 points. We cover 2 points.
We cover.
Most important part.
Yeah.
Next week, Sunday, September 15th on CBS at noon, we host the San Francisco 49ers.
Yeah, we lose that one.
I concur with that one. It's going to be a tough loss.
They got
going to learn a lot about our squad.
Yeah. I think our defense will keep us in the game, though.
Yes, I think so, but I think their defense is going to give our offense some fits.
I agree.
Week 3, Sunday, September 22nd, noon on CBS, we host the Houston Texans.
I think we beat them.
I don't.
I think Diggs comes in and thinks that.
That is true. But they got a lot of other options,
also,
too.
Also, did you see he's a captain?
That's interesting.
Like, what?
That is interesting. Also, when the Vikings announced their
that was me.
Captains, Sam Darnold does not have an Instagram or a Twitter account.
Does he actually not? No. And do you see Andrew DePaula is a captain again? And everyone's like, is it invite a fan? Is it a invite a fan Wednesday or whatever?
Yeah, I mean, okay. You never know. But he is. Yeah, he's been a captain for a while. I do not think we win this game.
Okay.
So I'm thinking like 1-2 right
now.
Okay, sweet, sweet, sweet. I'm glad you got it. Sunday, September 29th at Green Bay, noon on CBS. I can't believe we have the Vikings-Green Bay game at noon.
I can. Sunday. We're not winning in Green Bay.
I guess
Bay
it is
this
week
year.
Four.
We're not winning in Green Bay this year.
At Lambeau Field. Yeah, I agree. I concur. That's a tough start. 1-3.
Mm-hmm.
Assuming we win the first game.
Our schedule is the fourth or fifth hardest. It is
a tough.
The beginning of the schedule, for sure. The end gets a little better. And I think Kevin said that in an interview today.
It starts really tough, then we kind of coast in the middle, and then it's divisional, the end. And I think that's going to be the really tough part.
Yeah.
Week 5, Sunday, October 6th, 8:30 in the morning against the New York Jets. That's got to be in, like, England or something, Ireland, something like that.
Germany.
There we go. That makes sense.
Yeah, it's one of them.
Yeah, something like that.
No, it is in England.
Yeah, that makes
sense. Because Jordan Addison was doing a big thing about it.
It is in Tottenham Hotspur Stadium in London, Great Britain. It's 2:30 their time, 8:30 in the morning our time on NFL Network. Your thoughts?
My thoughts? I think we go and we get a win in England because we've played there before and we actually play pretty good. We beat the Saints 2 years ago when Lewisine snapped his whatever he snapped.
The only if this was a game at US Bank Stadium or a game at MetLife, I'd consider this a loss. But because we have experience playing in Tottenham 2 years ago, or was it last year?
2 years ago when Lewisine snapped his thingy. It was his rookie year.
Close win against the Jets. Book it. 2-3 again.
Can you move your cursor off of the thingy? Please on the
yeah,
sheet.
Yeah, where
is
it? Oh,
it's just that's like whenever I hover over. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I got you. Also, if at any point in this program,
you disagree,
or you want to just air out your thoughts. If say you're a Packers fan like Caden out there, I don't know if he's listening or not, but he's a.
And as long as it's not.
Yes, remember, profane. If you do call in, you cannot swear, or else we're billing you for $30,000
minimum.
The number to call, 605-658-6813. I'll give you a second before we talk about this next game, because it is our bye week. I'll give you a second, get your pen and paper out.
Hey, we can't lose.
Get your phone ready. You cannot lose in the bye week, which is week 6. The phone number to call the KAOR studio, 605-658-6813. Again, at any point in any of our shows, you want to call in, we'll stop everything and have a little chat with you.
Absolutely, we will.
As long as it's not 7:15, or else Grady might get mad at us. Because we do go from 6 to 7 p.m.
We do our best.
Week 6, bye week. Week 7, we host the Detroit Lions at noon on Fox.
See, the only reason I feel like we have a chance is because we're at home. But when is it? What day?
Sunday, October 20th.
Hmm.
With a Thursday night game the next week.
I think don't we get a ridiculous amount of time between the London game? Oh, we have a bye week? We have London bye game, week. I think we win
London
this game.
London game, bye week, we host Detroit.
I think we win this game.
I'm hopeful that we win this game. I don't think we do. Actually, wait, no, it's at home.
It's at home.
Yeah.
And we get like a like
we win.
3 weeks.
We win against the Detroit Lions at home.
At home.
At home.
I'm already taking the loss against the away side.
Week 18, count as a loss. Okay. Thursday, October 24th on Amazon Prime, we travel to the Los Angeles Rams.
I think the Rams are going to be better than people think. I think I have us losing this one.
I do, too. They're going to be a tough team on a short week traveling to L.A.
Yeah, to L.A. is
tough.
The rough part.
If it was a home game, then maybe.
Mm.
But at a loss. But
at the same time, their stadium usually doesn't sell out with Rams fans. We'll probably travel pretty well.
That is true. So right now, we're looking at – I'm predicting us at 3-4, and you're predicting us so far at 4-3 through week number 8. We move to week number 9, where we host the Indianapolis Colts at noon on CBS.
I got us a win on that one, just for the simple fact that I don't think Richardson's going to be healthy through week 3.
That is true. That is going to play a factor.
But they do have Flacco back there still.
But I'm going to assume that they're going to be healthy coming in, because I don't want to hope on people's injuries. I don't like watching that. So I think we're not going to win against the Colts. However, next week, Sunday, November 10th at Jacksonville.
Yeah, we win that
Duval!
One.
Duval!
Sure.
Yeah, we're winning that one. We are beating the Jags.
100%.
We can get a ticket for $43, Charlie.
Is it in?
It's in Jacksonville.
Oh, I'm not going to Jacksonville.
Oh, come on.
When is it?
November 10th.
I'm going to be deer hunting.
Yeah, I suppose. As we have 20 minutes left in the show.
We're doing fine.
Yeah, we're doing great. I just looked up, just chilling. We then head to the Tennessee Titans November 17th, noon on CBS.
Rack them up. We win this one.
Yep. 2 in a row, baby. 2 in a row. And that takes us to November 24th at Chicago, noon on Fox.
Hmm. I think we slip up. We always play terrible in Chicago on that field.
Yes, every time.
I'm taking a loss here.
I am also taking, because by that time, Caleb Williams and company have had 11 weeks to either burn the stadium to the ground or figure out what they're doing. And unfortunately, for the NFC North and for us, it's going to be the second one.
Yeah, I just don't feel like I can be confident in our team playing in Chicago. We always play terrible. I mean, every single time.
We have Sam Darnold as our starting quarterback.
Some people have some hope.
All right, through 12 weeks, we are currently looking at, I'm predicting us 5-6, Charlie's 7-4, which, by the way, the total season over-under is 6.5, according to Vegas.
Yeah, well, according to Vegas, they're wrong.
But here we go. We got a little streak going. We host the Arizona Cardinals on December 1st.
Are we going to count that one in the win column?
I agree. We host December 8th. On December 8th, we host the Falcons.
I'm going to be going to that game. And, okay, here's the thing. I've never been to a winning Vikings game. So, take that stat with
you. Haven't?
I've never been to a winning Vikings game.
Oh, you poor. Yes.
Nope.
No, when we didn't go last year, they lost.
Call.
It's Baker.
I went to 3 games last year and one before. I've been to 4 total games in my life. I've never seen a Vikings win. So, we'll see if we can break the curse. I'm taking a win.
Well,
according to stats, what are you going to do?
I'm going to take the loss, but you know how good I am at picking games, which, by the way, we'll get to that new segment in about 10 minutes or so. I think we lose, but again, I'm erring on the side of you because if I pick them to lose,
I will be really happy with you.
Exactly. Then we host the Chicago Bears Monday night on ABC and ESPN+.
I think we win it.
I think they sweep us.
You think so?
I think Chicago sweeps us.
I'm being really hopeful here, Cole.
I'm trying to be, but I have to be a realist.
Yeah,
I can't
be a realist. I'm being an optimist.
Yes, you're being an optimist. I'm not quite being a pessimist, but I think I'm being a realist. I'm maybe teetering on the edge a little bit. That's kind of how I roll. Sunday, December 22nd at Seattle, 3:05.
Yeah, we're losing that one. We're not going into Seattle and beating them.
Really? That's an interesting
thing. With that crowd, so I saw somewhere that the Vikings' only game they play and their only outdoor game between the whole last half of the season is outdoor in Seattle. Can you confirm that?
Well, in the last half of the season, they go at Jacksonville.
Outdoor.
At Tennessee.
Outdoor.
At Chicago.
Outdoor.
3 weeks at home.
Okay, yeah, this is where it starts. The 3 weeks at home.
Then it's at Seattle.
Outdoor.
At home.
At home, yeah.
At Detroit.
At home. Okay, so they're – okay. That's not bad. So
this will be the last outdoor game of the year.
Yeah, it'll be the last outdoor game of the year, and it's in Seattle. And I think it's going to be terrible conditions. What do you think, Cole? Win or loss?
I think we lose because it's hard to win at Seattle late in the season.
All right.
Because of the 12th man. Then on December 29th, we host the Green Bay Packers.
I think we're losing that one.
I think we win. Hear me out.
I'm hearing.
I think, here's the deal. I think the Bears sweep us for the first time in 75 years.
No way.
That's what I chose.
75 years.
Oh, I don't know. I just made that up.
Oh, I was going to say.
I just made that up.
That is not a stack.
No, I just made that up. I think the Bears go 2-0 against us, and I think we split against the other two.
Yeah.
Because I have them winning at home when we play Detroit, but we lose when we go to Detroit. We lost at Lambeau week 4. We're in a win at home. This game honestly might get flexed depending on how good we do.
Yeah. Yeah, honestly.
It usually does.
Yeah, it usually does. It's going to get flexed somewhere.
Yeah.
What week is it?
17.
Oh, yeah, you can flex 17. You can flex any time after 15 or 16, isn't it now?
I think you can flex all of them. You just have to know, 4 weeks ahead of time.
Yeah, but you have to pull some strings. You have to throw some money around.
But that's what the TV stations do.
Yeah.
That's what they can do because of their contract.
Yeah, well, if it's a Chiefs game, they
will host Green Bay. Then January 5th, they will travel to the Detroit Lions and take a loss.
I agree.
So we are looking at 7-10 and 10-7. Not bad. I'd say the ceiling is 10-7.
100%.
Your most likely is 7-10, 6-11, but your floor is 4-13.
I think there's 4 games they win this year.
Right. 100%. That's what I'm thinking. The floor. That's what the floor would be. Four.
For sure. Holy crap, Cole. We're on time.
Holy cow. That's the first time for everything. That's good because we can get to this, and then we can get to our losers of the week because I think that'll take a little bit more time this week. Just because you have to explain it, and then we're going to debate it.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm going to actually get the rules up while you present this.
So at this point, we just went through the Vikings preview. We have it on the record here on KAOR and podcastable, whether you're listening to Apple, Spotify, iHeartMedia, Amazon, because some people listen to it on their Amazon Echo. I didn't know that was possible. But shout out to you out there listening. And you can also find this on YouTube. Again, I try to get them up as fast as I can. You also check out all show updates on Twitter, at Charcole Sports on Twitter. That's where we post if we're going live or not, which I think we haven't missed a week that we've been here. I know one point I did a solo show because you were sick.
Yeah, I was bad.
But if we're not here, like if school's not in session, we don't have a show. Other than that, I don't think we've missed one. Anyway.
We'll pull some strings.
We have our picks for the college football and NFL champion, our predictions so far through week one of the college season. And
But we both had these picks since before. We just didn't get to them last week.
Yes. Yes, exactly right. This is we just wrote them down now. We knew them before. I can confirm both of your picks. For sure the college one you've been saying.
I have been saying this since July.
Since July, yes.
And they look pretty
would
decent.
Would you like to start or would I?
Well.
Here, let's flip a coin. I don't have one.
Well, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to talk about my my first one that I wrote, and then I'll talk about my actual one.
Go ahead.
So the first team I took was USD, just to joke around in the sheet with Cole to see if you get a laugh out of it. And then the NFL team I took was the Flat Killer Tomatoes, just to see what Cole would say. And he's like, what did you say? I forget. You said something to the effect of, I like your picks or something like that.
I did. I like both picks. Solid picks.
But we'll see if the KTs win it next year in amateur baseball and see if the Yotes can win this. My actual picks this year, if I'm not joking around, my college football pick to win it in the FBS is Ole Miss. I really liked what they had going on last year, and I really like what they have going on this year. Jackson Dart is really good, and as long as he stays away from injury, I think they make a true run at it and pull some stuff together and put together a pretty good team. It's just a question if their defense can help them win big games. And then my NFL pick is the Baltimore Ravens. Cole, what? Is something bad?
No, I was looking on this r/SCS sportsbook where they put out a line for every game from D1 to NAIA.
They do.
Mount Marty is a half-point favorite at Dakota Wesleyan this Saturday.
Oh, I'm taking Mount Marty minus 0.5 every time.
I think I might take him like minus a touchdown.
I agree.
Based on how D-Dub played. Yeah, uh-huh. Okay. So I saw that. I'm like, because I kept scrolling. I'm like, Nebraska West, that's NAI. I'm like, do they have all the NAI? Yes, they do. All right. You went through your picks, Ole Miss and the Ravens. I went through my picks. College football, they're going to return to glory with new head coach, formerly of the Coup, Kalen DeBoer.
Formerly of the Milbank Fire Chiefs. No, I'm just kidding. Milbank Bulldogs.
Yeah, Milbank Bulldogs. The Alabama Crimson Tide. I don't know. I just think there's some. You never really can count them out.
Well, here's the thing. Their offensive line is crazy.
Yes.
Their quarterback's serviceable.
Yes. I think there's a good chance. And now with the 12-team tournament, Alabama can lose twice and still make it.
Maybe three times.
Maybe.
I think you can make a case for Bama. Most teams in the SEC, you could probably make a case three losses besides the lower echelon like Vandy. No, but what the committee did last year.
Vandy's going undefeated. What do you mean?
Vandy's not going undefeated. I think you can make a case, especially for like teams like Ole Miss and Bama.
Yep.
I think you can make a case for Missouri maybe to have.
I think they're at two. Ole Miss still might be at two also.
Yeah, I agree. But I think Bama could lose three games. I think Georgia could lose. They're not going to lose three.
They're not going to with their schedule. I hope not anyway.
Right.
And my NFL pick, because I just wanted to throw something out there. They got the talent. I like cheering for them.
Fun team to watch.
Houston Texans, yes. Again, very offensive team. But we'll see how that translates. And we get to our new segment. Charlie, we are introducing a new segment here on the CharCole Sports Show. About time we think of a new segment. Am I right?
Yeah, well, we really didn't think of it. No, one of our listeners did.
Yeah, shout out to John.
Yeah.
John, if he's listening, he might be.
He might be, actually.
Yeah, there's a good chance of it.
Shout out to John for he dropped this last year. We were sitting in the Hanson High School gym watching my sister's volleyball game, and he hits me and says, hey, you want to play a loser's pool next year? And yeah, that was a conversation. And then he called me two and a half weeks ago. It might have been less, but he says, hey, I'm going to send you an email. What's your email? Okay, so I gave him my email. And here it is. So we're playing in the loser's pool, and I'm not going to give you the number, but it's high stakes. It's real high stakes.
Yes, it is.
Cole and I are.
But knowing my track record, I'm really good at picking losers.
Exactly right. But here's the rules, but there's the backstory. So the rules to this. So you pick four losers each week, straight up.
NFL.
NFL. No spread. For each game that you get correct, you get 1 point. It is a cumulative points total for the entire year, including and up to the Super Bowl. So you play through the playoffs into the Super Bowl. I don't believe, and I talked about it jokingly today, that the Pro Bowl is part of this.
But you never know.
Yeah, I'm
surprised it didn't start in the preseason, to be honest.
No kidding. But if you elect to play Thursday night football or Monday night football as one or two of your games respectively, and I know there are some two bangers in Monday night and Thursday night football as well, and I think that rolls over. I'll have to ask specifically to the admin, which is Tony.
Tony.
I really want to meet Tony, but he seems to be a good guy. He's the manager of this whole thing. But anyways, back to this. If you like to play Thursday night or Monday night football as one or two of your games for the week and get them correct, or get it correct, you get 1.5 points for the game. However, if you get that game wrong, you lose a half a point for the game, but you do not lose points on any other regular Sunday game. So if we were to pick the game tomorrow, which is the Chiefs and the Ravens, which we didn't even get to talk about the NFL schedule for the week, but
that's right. We can save that for next week.
Yeah, we can save it for next week. So say I were to take the Ravens tomorrow and the Ravens win, we get 1.5 points. But if I take the Ravens and the Ravens lose, then we lose a half a point. So we're already down a half a point. But if we take a Sunday game, we take the Vikings to lose on Sunday and they lose, it's indifferent, neutral, none, zero,
yep,
nada. So if you do not lose points on any other games, just Thursday night and Monday night football if chosen incorrectly. We email our picks and they lock in Thursday. And they need to be timestamped, texted, or emailed Thursday before the game starts with all four of your picks. Again, that's four picks, Cole, that we're making. And how this section is going to, or this, how this segment is going to go about for Cole and I is we're each going to come up with our four own losers separately. We're not going to talk about it. We're not going to converse. Go ahead.
We have not talked about them yet.
No. I got them on a sheet here for myself, and then we're going to converse, and then we're going to kind of go from there. And this is what this part of the show is going to be about. We're going to debate this. So, Cole, I'd like you to go ahead with your first four picks for our first week of the Losers Pool.
Oh, you want all four of them, huh?
Well, I guess.
You want to go one by one?
Yeah, we'll go one by one.
All right. My first pick, the Jaguars against the Dolphins. I believe the Jags are going to lose. This game is Sunday. Jags at Dolphins. The Jags are 3.5-point underdogs. It is at Miami.
Okay. All right. I can confirm that that is not one of my picks.
Oh, interesting.
But I like it now that I'm not. I like it now that I am listening.
I'm thinking about it
to your pitch. But and I feel like that'll be one of our four because I don't like a couple of my later picks. My first pick is the Cardinals, and I forget who they play, but I have the Cardinals as one
of
my
Cardinals. Leaders. Travel to Buffalo and take on the Bills.
And historically, I saw some sort of video that the Josh Allen absolutely torches teams that play man coverage like the Cardinals do. And even though his wide receivers aren't good, he's going to be fine. Dawson Knox and Kincaid are going to torch this team. Plus, the running game is going to be good. And Dalvin Cook's little brother, what's his name? He's a Cook. I don't know. His last name's Cook. But he's going to torch this team, and I think that the Cardinals are a team that's going to be losing.
Well, that transfers nicely to my second.
Do you got one?
I do have one. It is the Cardinals against the Bills.
Okay, so that's one of our locked-in
picks. That's going to be one of our final picks. I will type that in right here. Cardinals versus Bills.
Sweet.
There's pick number uno. All right, Charlie, your second pick.
My second pick is, and I got to find exactly who it is. I just wrote the pick down. I didn't write the game. Okay. I have the Patriots losing to the Bengals.
Yeah,
I just don't feel like Brissett can go out there against the Bengals, and especially with Joe Burrow being healthy, I think the Bengals are going to be pretty good. Plus, Joe Burrow's never, ever in the history of his career had a full training camp under his belt, and training camps are very, very important, according to Bill Belichick. He said, if my team had a good training camp, we were coming out and we're going to have a good season. So I'm taking the Patriots to lose to the Bengals.
Okay. That was your second pick, correct?
Yes.
Okay. I do not have the Patriots
okay.
and Bengals, but I do have The Las Vegas Raiders, who travel to Los Angeles to take on the Chargers. Yes, 305 on CBS. Chargers favored by 3. That's going to be my third pick.
All right, that's a good pick.
The Raiders to lose.
All right. My next pick. Oh, my gosh, what are we doing?
Are you putting them in this deal?
I'm putting them in my spreadsheet, and then I'll show you my spreadsheet.
Okay, good.
Spreadsheet,
okay, good.
When you're done.
Okay, good. I'm looking on here. I'm like, I hope he's keeping track.
I am.
I'm not paying attention.
My pick, and I don't know why I can't. Okay, there it is. I have the Commanders losing to the Buccaneers.
Interesting.
I don't feel good about it, and this is one I really want to change, and if you can convince me, I would like that.
Okay. I can confirm that is not my last pick.
I'm glad it's not.
My last pick is actually kind of a reach, if I'm being honest. The Cowboys to lose at Cleveland.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
Again, Cleveland is hosting, 325 on Fox. Cleveland is a 2.5-point favorite.
Okay. Well, good to know. Good to know. I think the defense is going to be crazy. Their D-backs,
yes,
are awesome.
Yes.
And especially with all the controversy and stuff, CD not having a full camp under his belt. I could see that. I could absolutely see that. My final pick is I have the Broncos losing to the Seahawks. Bo Nix is rookie premier. I just don't think that Bo Nix is going to be able to go out and win his first game against, especially it's in Seattle, man.
Can I do the honors and lock that one in?
Yeah, do you have that one?
No, I don't. I'm actually out of picks, but I like it a lot. I was teetering with it. That was going to be either my fourth pick or it was going to be just outside. So right now we have two locked in. We have the Cardinals losing to the Bills and the Broncos losing to the Seahawks.
Okay. I would like to second your pick of the Jaguars,
okay,
losing to the Dolphins, especially with everybody they got, and they really haven't had any controversy. Plus, everyone thinks that the Dolphins running backs are going to go crazy. We better get going.
Yeah, we do. Show ends technically in 10 seconds, but this segment will go quicker because we didn't have to explain the rules for 5 minutes. So we need our fourth pick yet. So right now available, I have the Raiders losing to the Chargers and the Cowboys losing to the Browns. What were the other two that you had?
I had the Commanders and the Broncos losing. And
we locked in the Broncos.
Right. So that's – I got to write this in. Hold on. So you had the Cardinals and the Raiders. Wait, we both had the Cardinals.
We both had Cardinals-Bills.
So we're down to the Raiders or – I'm sorry, I don't like the Cowboys.
Pick. That's fine. That's 100%. So it's either Raiders or whatever your last
Raiders
one was.
Raiders or Broncos.
We already had Broncos.
Oh, Commanders.
And the Commanders
Raiders
play.
Or Commanders. Raiders or Commanders.
The Commanders play at Tampa Bay. I don't mind that. I think Commanders. Commanders will lose.
Okay, lock it in. Cole, let's do a recap.
Versus the Bucks. All right, so our four final picks of the week for the NFL losers of the week. The Cardinals will lose to the Bills. The Broncos will lose to the Seahawks. The Jags will lose to the Dolphins. And the Commanders will lose to the Bucks. All games on Sunday.
Sunday.
Whoa, I just punched my microphone.
Cole, hit the music. I'll talk about this. Our picks of the week happening here. Let's talk about last week. Cole went 3-3. He's a solid 500. I went 2-4. We have decided today that the format is going to be consistent this year. We're each going to pick 6 games a week. It doesn't matter what classification, sport, or anything like that. 6 picks, that's how it's going to go. It makes more sense. So, Cole, I'm not going to go over your picks because we don't really have time. But Cole went 3-3, had a pretty good week, and I had a bad week for the first time in a long time. So I went 2-4. This week, Cole, got your picks?
Yes, I do. 2 high school football picks. In the Battle of the Christian Schools in 11A, I take Sioux Falls over Rapid City. And in 9B, I have Kadoka Area upsetting 9A Wall. College, I'm just going to roll right through them. College football, Kansas -5 against Illinois. Tennessee -8 against NC State. For the NFL, I have the Lions -3.5 against the Rams and the Texans -3 against the Colts. Hoping to roll with my winning week so
far.
Yeah,
absolutely. So this week I have TDA ACDC, my high school football pick, a Class 9AA team coming down from 11B over Corsicana in Class 9B. I just don't think Corsicana can keep it up, especially against two teams in Class 9AA. And then I have Wagner over Hot Springs in Class 11B. In college football, I have Texas minus 7.5 over Michigan. I think Texas is going to mollywop them. And then I have Nebraska minus 7 over Colorado. I just think with what they
have. Roll Skurs, baby!
Yeah, and I didn't even do this based off Cole. I just truly think Nebraska is going to win the game.
So, I'll be in attendance.
Yeah, Cole will be in attendance for that
83 rows up in the north end zone.
We'll find you on TV. I'll probably flip it on. What time is it? Kickoff?
6:30.
6:30 p.m.?
Yep. Night game.
Oh, my. Well, we'll have to watch that one. Nebraska minus 7 over Colorado. And then my NFL pick, I have the Vikings minus 1.5 over the Giants and the Steelers plus 3.5 over the Falcons. I feel like 3 is good. Falcons are going to win by 3. So I like this one a lot. So Steelers plus 3.5. Cole, let's get out of here.
Again, you can listen to the shows back on Apple Music, Spotify, YouTube, whatever your podcasts are. Again, check us out on Twitter. We post constant updates. We're back next week, 6 to 7 p.m. You're listening to the CharCole Sports Show on KAOR 91.1 in Vermilion. Thanks for tuning in. See you next week.
Closing time, turn all of the lights on over every boy and every girl. Closing time, one last call for alcohol, so finish your whiskey or beer. Closing time, you don't have to go home, but you can't stay.